background lecture. So here I am again in this esteemed lecture series, and I tell you with complete honesty that I am the least distinguished speaker you'll hear all semester. But I'm happy to be back because this lecture series always reminded me of the reasons why I became a professor, which is we live in here, we live the life of the mind. And I'll try to do a little bit of that today for you when I tell you how historians have tried to make sense of the Holocaust. So you should know that I'm not a historian of Germany. My German language abilities are pretty rudimentary. I'm a historian of the Soviet Union. So I'm an outsider to the field of Holocaust studies, and what this means is I can deflect questions. If you ask me questions I can't answer, I'll just say, I don't know. And I'll ask Bittner or Diane or Barbara, who know far more about this than I do, to answer on my behalf. But just because I'm an outsider to the field of German history and Holocaust studies, does not mean I haven't thought about the Holocaust. And in truth, there's a good deal of theoretical overlap in the scholarship on Nazism and Stalinism. And they're joined by a concept, which we call totalitarianism. And totalitarianism is a word which is not so often used these days, but it was once so overused, particularly among social scientists, that it became almost devoid of meaning. And the word was coined 50 years ago by two political scientists at Harvard University, Carl Friedrich and Zbigniew Brzezinski, to refer to political regimes like Nazi Germany and Stalinist Soviet Union that had totalizing ambitions. And what that means, totalizing ambitions, it means that they sought to control not only actions that occurred in public, but actions that occurred in private. They sought to control every aspect of the life of their citizens. Now, Stalinism and Nazism are also linked with the concept of genocide, albeit less frequently and, in my mind, less satisfactorily, because I don't think the Soviet Union was ever genocidal, although I admit that this is a point of contention. And I can say this because I come to you directly from Kiev. I was in Kiev last week. And the Ukrainians are convinced that the Stalinist regime was, in fact, genocidal. It was genocidal. The vehicle of genocide was the Ukrainian famine. Now, by the way, in this comparison between Nazi Germany and Stalinist Russia, this comparison is one, I think, where the Soviet Union comes out looking pretty good. And it speaks to one of the great ironies of the 20th century, that the Soviet Union, a communist country, saved the capitalist world from its worst excesses by defeating Nazi Germany. And of course, the Soviet Union was the principal victor by almost any index, any criteria. Was the principal victor in the war against fascism. Now, it's also true that the Holocaust was principally an Eastern European and a Soviet event. Now, our image of the Holocaust here in the United States tends to be very different. Our image of the Holocaust is one of Vichy collaborators and Anne Frank holed up in her attic in Amsterdam. But the truth is that the vast majority of persons who perished in the Holocaust resided in Eastern Europe. Now, if we include lands that were partitioned by the Soviet Union in 1939, according to the terms of the infamous Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, sometimes called the Stalin-Hitler Pact, about half of the victims of the Holocaust were Soviet citizens. And this reflects the fact that the heartland of European Jewry, the lands that comprise the old Pale of Settlement in Ukraine, in Belarusia, and in Lithuania, were left almost completely devoid of Jews at the end of the war. In fact, the very famous Soviet Jewish writer, Ilya Ehrenberg, wrote a famous essay at the end of the war Ukraine Hebrea, Ukraine without Jews. The point of this essay was to reflect on this fact that this land, which had once been the epicenter of Jewishness in Europe, had been wiped clean. So I think this is what qualifies me to speak about the Holocaust. If I were to ask you what the Holocaust is, I am confident that nearly all of you could answer. In fact, you could all answer. You wouldn't be in this class if you didn't know prima facie what the Holocaust was. The Holocaust was the event when German soldiers, political leaders, bureaucrats, and their non-German abettors planned and implemented the systematic murder of 6 million Jews, smaller numbers of Roma, the Gypsies, Slavic persons, handicapped persons, homosexuals, communists, Jehovah's Witnesses. As such, the Holocaust is the central event in all of German history. It is the central event in modern European history. By the way, modern age, we typically say, begins with the French Revolution. Right? So 1789, the central event after 1789. The Holocaust colors our understanding of what it means to be German and European. And the Holocaust forces us to rethink events as pivotal as the European Enlightenment. I'll try to do a little of that for you today. So, what was the Enlightenment? Well, the Enlightenment was the political version of the scientific revolution. It's a period that really doesn't have exact dates. I think generally historians date its beginning sometime around 1650, and it goes on to about the French Revolution in 1789. It's this period of philosophic and political awakening, where philosophers and enlightened political leaders like Frederick the Great, Catherine the Great. Frederick the Great was the leader of Prussia, Prussia with a P, the precursor to modern Germany. Catherine the Great, the Russian Empress. Enlightened leaders like these persons tried to apply rational scientific laws to the realm of politics. So the Enlightenment produced the American Revolution in 1776 and the French Revolution in 1789. But more important, the Enlightenment gave us the idea, which no doubt many of you subscribe to, that human existence can be perfected and improved upon. And I tell you, there is no more dangerous idea in all of this human history than that. And in some strange ways, it's what underlay the Holocaust. So I'm sure all of you could answer the question what the Holocaust is, what the Holocaust was. But if I were to ask you why the Holocaust happened, I suspect you would find it much more difficult to answer. Why did hundreds of thousands of seemingly normal, intelligent, and otherwise moral Germans participate in mass murder? Why did millions of their countrymen do nothing to stop them? As the historian Daniel Jonah Goldhagen pointed out a few years ago, is that an earthquake? Do I still get paid if there's an earthquake? So let's see if we can start off. So I used to have a car that, you know, malfunctioned, but you did the same thing at work.
Yeah, I understand.
So as the historian Daniel Jonah Goldhagen pointed out a few years ago, your answers to this question, why did the Holocaust happen, would probably have as much to do with the nature of human existence, to what Joseph Conrad famously called the heart of darkness that resides in us all, than with the individual motivations of persons who participated in murder. Now, I'm not so naive to think that we're going to answer this question today.
This would be very embarrassing if the speaker were more esteemed than myself. So I'm not so confident that we're going to be able to answer this question today, and I'm fairly confident, in fact, that if we could fast forward in time 100 years ago, students in this classroom, or hopefully in a much better classroom, will be asking the same question here at Sonoma State: why the Holocaust happened. But today, I think I can provide you with a few conceptual tools and the historical background so you can begin to formulate an answer on your own. So I'm going to provide you today with some conceptual tools and historical background so you can begin to formulate an answer on your own. And I'm going to do this by identifying three structural developments, which in my mind facilitated the Holocaust, and then move on to the specific circumstances under which the Nazis came to power in Germany in 1933, and then how they went about persecuting the Jews. And then I'll conclude with some thoughts on the ways historians have tried to make sense of this all, and that will take us into the realm of interpretation. So, my first structural development that I think helped set the stage for the Holocaust, I'm simply going to call anti-Semitism. And as a former speaker in this lecture series has noted in one of his books, and this is Yehuda Bauer, who's on faculty in Tel Aviv, in Israel, historian of the Holocaust. Yehuda Bauer has pointed out that anti-Semitism is in fact a stupid term. There is no doctrine of Semitism to be opposed to, as Bauer has very astutely noted. Nonetheless, in its common usage, anti-Semitism refers to animosity towards Jews, but not toward other Semitic peoples, like the Arabs. So, where does anti-Semitism come from? So, in some forms, anti-Semitism is as old as Christianity itself. Many verses in the New Testament strike the modern reader with modern sensibilities as anti-Semitic. And these verses probably reflect tensions in the early Christian movement between Jews who accepted the idea that Christ was the Savior, the Messiah who had been predicted in the book of Isaiah, and Jews who did not accept that idea. But much of Christian anti-Semitism hinges upon the idea that Jews were somehow responsible for the death of Christ. So according to the book of John, Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor in Jerusalem, was ready to pardon Christ, but he was convinced otherwise by a hostile Jewish crowd. And according to the book of Matthew, Caiaphas, the Jewish high priest in Jerusalem, helped fabricate evidence against Jesus. Now, in fairness, a fuller reading of the book of Matthew suggests that Caiaphas did this in order to stave off a Roman military incursion. So he sacrificed Christ to save others. Nonetheless, as a result of this, until the 20th century, it was accepted doctrine in the Roman Catholic Church that Jews were responsible for the death of Christ. And this alone was often the cause of popular animosity towards Jews. So for instance, when the plague hit Europe in the 14th century, there were persistent rumors that the plague was caused by Jews who had poisoned the water. There were also rumors all across Europe that persisted well into the 20th century. In fact, I've seen in Russian archives documents refer to this. There were rumors that Jews used the blood of Christian children in their Passover matzahs. Everybody know what a matzah is? It is not the greatest Jewish contribution to the world of high cuisine. It is unleavened bread that resembles a square frisbee. Now, along with Muslims, Jews were targeted by the Crusades, from the 11th to the 13th centuries. Jews were objects of the Inquisition. In the 12th and 13th centuries, Jews were repeatedly expelled from France. They were expelled from Spain in 1492. They were expelled from parts of Prussia, begin with a P, in the 1700s. And in the Russian Empire, where many displaced Jews moved, Jews displaced from the Iberian Peninsula in 1492, Jews were legally confined to what was called the Pale of Settlement, which were lands in present-day Ukraine, Belarus, Lithuania, and Poland. Now, in large parts of Eastern Europe, Jews were forbidden from owning land, and this gives us the most pernicious stereotype of Jewishness, the Jewish merchant and the Jewish money changer. And like all stereotypes, this one has a kernel of truth, and the kernel of truth is, this is all that Jews were allowed to do, right? Because they couldn't own land. They couldn't farm like the majority of the population. Unexpected or unexplainable tragedies frequently resulted in pogroms. This is a wonderful word. It means little storm in Russian. It refers more colloquially to small, popular, unplanned, spontaneous uprisings against Jews. So my point here is that anti-Semitism has been with us for a very long time, 2,000 years. But over the course of the 19th century, anti-Semitism changed in a fundamental way. Generally speaking, it became less religious in orientation and more racial in orientation. And this reflected two developments. First of all, Jewish lives were increasingly urban. Many Jews were no longer practicing. Men did not wear beards and the yarmulke. And in the Russian Empire, movement in and out of the Pale of Settlement was tolerated. So the visible markers of Jewishness began to fade. And in the absence of visible markers, people began to imagine that the markers of Jewishness were intrinsic, right? They're in the blood. So what it means to be Jewishness was then transformed into something that was ethnic. Now the switch from religious to racial anti-Semitism also reflected many pseudo-scientific theories that were in vogue in the 19th century, and that attributed certain defining physical and mental characteristics to ethnic and racial groups. So could you go forward one slide now? So here we have one of these classes in eugenics, the pseudoscience of race, being taught in the German school in the 1930s. And so presumably this child is being instructed into what are the defining characteristics of Jewishness. And whether or not we want to admit it, we know that these ethnic stereotypes exist, right? Englishmen are individualistic. Germans are punctual. Irishmen are drunkards. Jews were associated with less savory characteristics. Jews were perceived as greedy, as rootless, and as cosmopolitan. And this latter word, cosmopolitan, it meant the same thing in the 19th century that it means today. Today it means to be worldly and sophisticated. But in the 19th century, the values were reversed. This was seen as a bad thing to be worldly, because it suggested that Jews had little loyalty for the nations in which they lived, but instead had loyalty to various transnational groups like the Jewish diaspora, or political movements like Zionism. And of course, Zionism is the Jewish form of nationalism. And even some people thought that cosmopolitanism, the Jewish cosmopolitanism, made Jews especially prone to ideologies like socialism and communism. Now, if you've been paying attention, you can see that there's a contradiction here. For anti-Semites, Jews are both greedy and they're prone to communism. But how can you be a greedy communist? That's an oxymoron. And this is what the sociologist Zygmunt Bauman calls the viscosity of Jewish identity. Jewish identity, at least as it is perceived by anti-Semites, is always slippery. So Jews can be arch-capitalists, greedy in the extreme, the money changer, right? And Jews can be conniving, atheistic Bolsheviks, dedicated to the triumph of global communism. Now, this is hardly an exhaustive list of the indignities to which Jews have been subjected, and it's really not meant to be one. But I do want to underscore a point that the historian Jan Gross has made in his study of the way the Holocaust has played out in a single Polish village. Now, according to Gross, before the Holocaust, anti-Semitism from the perspective of Jews was a lot like a low-intensity, intractable war. So Jews, particularly in the East, in Eastern Europe, had to be savvy to survive. A moment's carelessness, a careless glance, a careless joke could produce an insult that would lead to a pogrom. But the point is that a low-intensity war is survivable. In all but a few extraordinary cases, the Holocaust was not survivable. Okay, so anti-Semitism is my first structural characteristic that will set the stage for the Holocaust. My second structural characteristic, I'm going to call nationalism. It's another word that's used so often that it's often devoid of meaning. So we have to define some of these terms. Nationalism is a political doctrine that holds that each nation should have its own state. Okay? So that begs the question then, what is a nation? Well, a nation is a group of people with some perceived affinity. Right? And that affinity can be culture, it can be religion, it can be ethnicity, it can be some combination of the above. Now, the social scientist Benedict Anderson says that this is always an imagined affinity, because it's never the case that you will know every other person in your nation. So you have to imagine that these people have some affinity to you. Okay? Now, despite what nationalists say, and nationalists often argue that the origins of their nations are located in the distant past. So for instance, the Romanians claim to be the true and rightful successor to ancient Rome. That's simply not true. So despite what nationalists say, nations are relatively recent phenomena in human history. Even the oldest nations have only existed for 200 years. Many of the nations in Eastern Europe, considerably younger than this. So in Western Europe, the signal event for early nationalists was the French Revolution in 1789. And the French Revolution located political sovereignty, that is the right to rule, in the broad citizenry rather than in a narrow aristocracy or a royal family. And in doing so, the French Revolution created the idea of the French nation. Right, it then took the French state 100 years to convince everybody within the boundaries of France that they were in fact French, rather than Breton or Catalan or of the Languedoc. There were all these regional identities that were gradually replaced by a national identity. Now, in Central and Eastern Europe, where territories were incorporated into the multinational Russian and Austro-Hungarian empires, or were petty principalities, semi-autonomous territories that would soon comprise modern Germany. Nationalism was shaped in important ways by a cultural movement called Romanticism. And we say that this is Romanticism with a big R. Right? Now, in its broadest sense, Romanticism refers to a movement in art, in thought, in cultural sensibility, in which feeling and imagination are emphasized instead of science and rationality. And as such, Romanticism was a reaction to the French and the American Revolutions. Because the French and the American Revolutions entrenched the idea that historical progress defines human existence. Right? That history is the story of progress. And the French and the American Revolutions seem to bear this out. The present is better than the past. Will be better, even better yet. Well, Romanticism is a reaction to this confidence. Romanticism expressed deep anxiety about the extent and pace of social and cultural change. Romanticism was skeptical of science. It was skeptical of the claim that man had mastered the secrets of nature. Romanticism portrayed the sense of vulnerability and anxiety that had beset modern man. And of course, the classic work of Romantic literature, probably many of you have read, it's Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. Right? And the moral of Frankenstein is that there are some realms into which humans should not delve. Right? The creation of life, for instance, that belongs to the divine. Now, romantic nationalists, like the poet, German poet Johann Gottfried von Herder, and the composer Richard Wagner, celebrated folk culture as the only constant in this sea of change. And in folk culture, Herder and Wagner located the kernel of the authentic national soul, which had existed, they argued, for ages and ages. So in other words, the nation was unified because it shared this cultural patrimony of the folk culture. Now the irony here is that many of these romantic nationalists, like Richard Wagner and Herder, were worldly, polyglot means they speak many different languages, worldly, polyglot intellectuals. They spend their days hanging out in cafes. They're as comfortable in Paris, Rome, Berlin. So they're men of the world who idealize the lives of illiterate peasants because they're convinced that these peasants have something in them which has not been corrupted by modernity. Now, as a political doctrine, nationalism was and is one of the most successful of all time. So over the course of 100 years, Europe ceased to be a continent of empires, and it became instead a continent of nation states. That is, states that based their legitimacy, their right to exist, on the will of the nation. And again, the nation is nothing more than this imagined group. So, Serbia. Serbia gets partial independence in 1815 from the Ottoman Empire. Full independence in 1918 at the end of the First World War. Greece comes into existence in 1829. And now I'm going to read you a very long list of nations. And it's probably not so important that you record them all in your notes, but to know that the 19th century is the period when these nations come into existence, the 19th and early 20th centuries. So Greece, 1829. Romania, 1859. Italy, 1861. Germany, 1871. Bulgaria, 1878. Albania, 1912. Czechoslovakia, 1918. Now this is an unusual nation state because it is a state of two nations. right? Czechs and the Slovaks, and they share a state. And then we have a whole slew of nation states born in the aftermath of the First World War. Poland, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, Hungary, Ukraine, and Turkey all date their origins as nation states between 1918 and 1923. But nationalism also caused problems. And you have a handout that attests to these problems. The borders that were drawn between nation states were rarely perfect. Romanians lived in Russia. Ukrainians lived in Poland. Germans lived in Czechoslovakia, in the famous Sudetenlands. Turks lived in Bulgaria. The list goes on and on and on. Millions of people lived outside of their titular nation state. Titular. When I was in high school, whenever I heard the word titular, I always giggled, because I imagined it referred to something profane. It's actually an adjective that refers to of the title. Right? These are people who have a nation state, right, but they live outside that nation state, because the borders that were drawn between nation states were not perfect. And then there are the Jews. The Jews had a nationalist ideology, Zionism, but they had no nation state. And they would not have a nation state until the end of the Second World War. And then it was not even in Europe. Okay. So my second structural characteristic that I can help set the stage for the Holocaust is nationalism. And then my third characteristic I'm going to call militarism. So after 1870, every major European power is maintaining a standing army, army that exists in peacetime. The major powers are spending increasing sums of money on weapons production. So military spending doubles in France between 1875 and 1914. It triples in Britain and Germany. And in Russia, by 1914, the military accounted for a full one-third total state expenditures. And I can tell you that even by present-day American standards, that is a lot of money that's being spent on the military. So by the eve of the First World War, there were 19 million men and women who were already in uniform. And military thinking and military values began to pervade European society. Now this militarism was spurred on by technology. The machine gun comes into existence in the 1860s, right at the end of the American Civil War. New industrial processes made possible the development of far larger pieces of artillery. By 1914, the Germans had artillery that could launch a shell 75 miles. Naval architecture is also in transformation. At the end of the 19th century, warships are still built principally out of wood. By the time of the First World War, warships are being built out of steel. And by the early 1900s, a new vessel of unprecedented size is coming into use. The British call it the dreadnought. The Americans call it the battleship. And it was really nothing more than a floating artillery platform. And then even more ominously, nations began to experiment with the use of chemical arms. Of course, the First World War saw the widest use of chemical weapons. But I think even more important than these technological advances, the idea of violence was becoming culturally acceptable in Europe. People of all political persuasions, from Marxists on the left, to social Darwinists on the right, liberals in the middle, they all thought that struggle between people was historically necessary, and maybe even beneficial. In jingoism, rather than patriotism, becomes the approved standard of expressing one's loyalty to the nation. And jingoism refers to a very bellicose form of nationalism. And this enthusiasm for violence was manifested in extremely low rates of desertion once the First World War actually began. So the French command anticipated that desertion rates would range somewhere between 5 and 13% among French soldiers. Because after all, it was very easy for French soldiers to desert. They could walk home in many instances. As it turned out, the desertion rate in the French army was 1.5%. And this suggests that even among people who bore the brunt of violence, that they understood that it was somehow necessary. It had been ingrained in them. Okay, so those are the three developments that helped set the stage for the Holocaust. So I'm going to switch gears now and talk about the circumstances under which the Nazis came to power. So Nazi success built upon the failures of German liberalism. In particular, the failures of what was called the Weimar Republic. And Weimar was the city where the new German constitution was drafted after Germany's capitulation in the First World War in October-November 1918. Now, the Weimar Republic lasted until 1933. And during this period, 1918 to 1933, it was arguably the world's most democratic state. In fact, I had an MA student here at Sonoma State who finished a few years ago who wrote her thesis on the sort of emigration of African-American jazz musicians to Weimar, in particular, Josephine Baker. By American standards, Weimar was seen as very accepting of African Americans. Now, Weimar also had many weaknesses. I think probably many of you have heard about the onerous reparations that were placed upon the German Weimar Republic by the Treaty of Versailles. But I think equally important was political polarization between the extreme left and the right. So for instance, on November 9, 1918, the day German liberals proclaimed the formation of the Weimar Republic, this is a republic modeled upon the Western democracies, Karl Liebknecht, a German socialist, proclaimed the formation of a pro-Soviet socialist republic. And there was actually a little bit of confusion about what this new German state was going to be. Was it going to be free market liberal democracy? Or was it going to be a Soviet-style socialist state? And then there were right-wing uprisings in the Weimar Republic in 1920 and 1923 that capitalized on popular disenchantment with the economy. Now, in the summer of 1929, the American economy slipped into recession. In October of 1929, the New York Stock Exchange tanked. Europe collapsed within weeks. After the crash, American financiers were no longer able to continue infusing capital into the German economy. And this was really essential. This was the plan that had been devised by Charles Dawes, who was American vice president in the 1920s. He figured out a way that would allow the German state to pay its reparations with loans that were provided by American banks. But after 1929, American banks were no longer able to provide these loans. By 1932, American investment on the continent of Europe had fallen by 70%. And this was particularly rough for Germany, as I said, was dependent upon these American loans to pay its war reparations. So not surprisingly, Germany was the first state to experience political upheaval on account of this global recession that would turn into a global depression. So in September 30, in parliamentary elections, German voters stunned the pundits by handing 107 seats to the National Socialist Party. Now, 107, that doesn't mean anything unless you know the scale. There are 611 seats total in the German Reichstag. So 107 is one sixth of the total seats. So overnight, the Nazis, as they were called by their acronym, went from being an inconsequential party to comprising the second largest bloc in the Reichstag after the Social Democrats, which was a center-left party. So the Nazis, in other words, were the prime beneficiaries in Germany of this mounting economic crisis. So you know the Nazis were led by Adolf Hitler. Hitler was born in Austria in 1889. As a young man, he had dabbled as a painter, but he had been denied admission to the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna. Hitler had served with the German infantry in the First World War. He twice received the Iron Cross, which is the German equivalent of the Purple Heart, for surviving poison gas attacks. Now, after the war, Hitler joined the Nazi Party. He did not found it, he joined an existing party. Nazi is the German acronym for National Socialist, and this requires a little bit of explanation. Socialist here is not intended to be understood in its Marxist sense. Rather, socialist here, was meant to convey the sense of solidarity that supposedly existed among German veterans of the First World War. Now, in 1923, Hitler was arrested for participating in a coup against the Bavarian government in Munich, famous Beer Hall Putsch. The coup plotters were caught before any damage could be done. Probably some of them were drunk. And Hitler was sentenced to 9 months in prison. And it was while he was in prison that Hitler wrote the book that would become the Bible of the Nazi movement, Mein Kampf, My Struggle. And in this book, Mein Kampf, Hitler laid out his view of history. So contrary to Marx, who argued that history was the product of class struggle between contending classes, Hitler claimed instead that Hitler was driven by struggle between the races. In Hitler's view, there was a master race, so-called Aryans, and the Aryans were the predecessors, the Germans and the Brits, the Anglo-Saxons. And these people were ordained by God to be the implacable foe of lesser races, particularly the Jews, but also the Slavs. Now, according to Hitler, Germany had to adopt an aggressive foreign policy in order to achieve its historical destiny. He thought that Germany had to conquer essential Lebensraum in Eastern Europe, living space in Eastern Europe. He always understood that this expansion would anger France, Germany's traditional antagonist to the West. But he thought, wrongly as it turned out, that Britain would never send troops to the continent to stop this expansion. Because he was convinced that the Brits would one day realize this racial difference they had with Germans. So these are the core elements of Nazi ideology, racial superiority on one hand, and the need for expansion on the other. And these really provide the basis for future Nazi policies. Now, Hitler came to power almost by accident. Despite the impressive showing of the Nazis in 1930, they still played second fiddle to the largest party in the Reichstag, the Social Democrats. By 1932, the Nazis had become the strongest party in numeric terms, but they were still far from a majority. They had 230 of the 611 seats. Moreover, in 1932 and 1933, there's some evidence that suggests that the Nazis were actually losing support to their arch rival. to the communists, which was polling a distant third behind the social democrats and the Nazis. And I think this suggests, you know, if the Nazis are bleeding voters and the communists, this suggests that the political spectrum, which we often imagine as having a right and a left and a center, the political spectrum is actually a circle, right? And if you go far enough right, you actually begin to come back left. That's what I'm telling myself about. So lots of people thought at the beginning of 1933 that the Nazi phenomenon was fading. But ironically, the Nazi seizure of power can be attributed at least in part to the commitment among social democrats to the creation of liberal bourgeois democracy. So the German chancellor tried to convince the German president. The German president in 1933 is a man named Paul von Hindenburg, who was actually the general who led German soldiers in the Second World War, the First World War. So the chancellor tried to convince Hindenburg to just ban the Nazis and the communists. And Hindenburg refused. And he refused because he saw it as a violation of the freedoms that were guaranteed by the Constitution that had been drafted in Weimar in 1918. Right? You just can't outlaw speech in political parties that you find odious. But clearly, something had to be done to constrain the Nazis. And the solution seemed ingenious at the time, but in retrospect, I think we can identify it as the greatest screw-up ever. So Hindenburg offered Hitler the chancellorship in January of 1933. So go forward one more slide, please. And as chancellor, Hitler would rule over a coalition cabinet which contained only three Nazis among the 11 seats. And in the eyes of Hindenburg and others, once Hitler was in power, he would have to tone down his rhetoric and behave more responsibly. Right? Because lots of people say insane things when they're running for president. But when they become president, we expect them to act presidential. I am drawing no parallels. So, and then some people even thought that Hitler would be little more than a puppet who could be easily controlled while he was in the chancellor position. So here you see this moment Hitler is invited into power. But once he was in power, Hitler moved quickly to consolidate his position. He demanded that new elections be called to the Reichstag. This was his right as chancellor. These elections were going to be held in early March 1933. But on February 27, 1933, the Reichstag building burned down. And the fire was probably set by a Nazi arsonist, but Hitler blamed the communists. By noon of the following day, some 4,000 communists had been arrested, and Hindenburg signed an emergency decree suspending individual liberties. And in the ensuing days, in virtually every big and medium-sized city in Germany, Nazi thugs terrorized their political opponents. And this set the stage for a Nazi electoral triumph on March 5. So the Nazis, in these parliamentary elections, won 44% of the vote. This is not a majority, but they had an ally. They had an ally in the party called the Nationalist Party. And so Hitler was able to claim a majority of seats in the Reichstag. Less than 3 weeks later, the Reichstag approved a body of law that is called the Enabling Act. The Enabling Act authorized the government to rule by decree for 4 years. So essentially, with the Enabling Act, the Reichstag is decreeing itself out of existence.
existence.
And I see here in my notes, well, this lecture has been written for a long time, I see that I wrote here at some point in my notes, Hugo Chavez. I have no idea why I wrote that there, of the enabling act. So, Hitler had become a dictator, even though a majority of the German population had not voted for the Nazis. Now, two factors made the Nazi expansion so rapid. First, the Nazis relied on the work of the Gestapo, later the SS, the secret police. And secondly, thousands of bureaucrats and state officials joined the Nazi Party to advance their own careers. So where might opposition to the Nazis have come from? Well, the traditional institution that was most likely to give Hitler trouble was the army. And it's pretty clear that the officer corps of the German military had little respect for their new chancellor. Probably because they were afraid he was going to get them involved in a war. But of course, military support for Hitler's aggressive foreign policy was crucial. So on the night of June 30, 1934, Hitler accused several prominent generals of homosexuality, and he ordered the secret police to assassinate these generals. This has become known as the Night of Long Knives in the history of the Nazi period. When Hindenburg died of natural causes 5 weeks later, the beginning of August 1934, Hitler combined the offices of chancellor and president. The effective opposition to the Nazis may also have come from the Christian churches. So the Nazi electoral triumph in 1933 was made possible by support for Protestant bourgeois voters. So in other words, if you look at who's actually voting for the Nazis in 1930 and 1933, the typical Nazi voter is Protestant and middle class. But nonetheless, most Protestant clergymen tried to remain politically neutral. And a very small minority of Protestant clergymen organized an active resistance that denounced Nazi racism. And some 800 Protestant clergymen died in camps during the Nazi period for resisting them. Now, opposition might also have come from the Vatican. And here I'm actually going to change a little bit what I've said in the past, just because I've done some reading on this since I last stood at this podium. So in 1933, Hitler signed a treaty with the Vatican. And in this treaty, Pope Pius XI gave his stamp of approval to the Nazi regime in return for the recognition of the traditional liberties that the Roman Catholic Church had enjoyed in Europe, particularly in Germany. Now, unfortunately, this treaty with Hitler that the Vatican signed undermined the ability of a prominent party in German politics to oppose the Nazis. So Catholics in Germany typically voted for a party that was called the Catholic Center Party. But here, the Vatican has signed a treaty with them. And so that obviously makes it difficult for the Catholic Center Party to oppose it. But nonetheless, Hitler's assurances to the papacy about respecting Roman Catholicism really proved to be worthless. In the mid-1930s, Nazis ruthlessly attacked Catholic schools and Catholic youth groups. And eventually, Pope Pius XI decided that he had made a mistake, that this 1933 treaty was a mistake. And so in 1937, he issues an encyclical, papal encyclical, which is called in English, With Burning Sorrow. And here I'm going to speak off my notes. So this was quite a thing, this papal encyclical. It was actually smuggled into Germany, and on a designated Sunday, the pastor in every Roman Catholic church in Germany read this papal encyclical at considerable risk to themselves, I must point out. Now, in this papal encyclical, Pope Pius XI denounces what he calls the cult of race. Now, there's a debate among historians about whether this was explicit enough, whether it was understood by people who were in church that Sunday that this meant that anti-Semitism was unchristian, or whether some historians have argued that the language that Pope Pius XI used was purposely ambiguous on this point. Okay? Now, I want to point out, I'm actually kind of softening things up here for the Roman Catholic Church, because typically I've been fire and brimstone here on their guilt in this all. And I think that I, in the past, I've probably overstated that, and that this is actually a matter of dispute among historians. So, Nazi racism was directed principally against the Jews. So in 1933, after coming to power, Hitler expelled most Jews from state administrative positions. 2 years later, in 1935, he issued the infamous Nuremberg Laws, which denied German citizenship to persons with two or more Jewish grandparents. So that becomes the legal definition of what it means to be Jewish. The Nuremberg Laws prohibited marriage and sexual intercourse between Germans and Jews. It required Jews to wear the yellow Star of David in public. German towns were allowed to refuse residency to Jews. German businesses were forced to fire their Jewish employees. Now, Jews, of course, are not naive, right? They know what's going on. They know that this is exceptional. This goes beyond that sort of low-intensity, intractable war I spoke about earlier. And so by 1938, 100,000 German Jews had fled abroad. If they were lucky, they fled to Switzerland, or to the UK, or to the United States, or to the lands that would become Israel. If they were unlucky, they fled to France, right? Because there they would later get rolled up in the years of Holocaust. On November 8th of 1938, the Jews who remained behind were subjected to an event that has become known as Kristallnacht, Night of Broken Glass. Scores of Jews were killed, thousands were dragged from their homes into the streets and beaten, 200 synagogues were burned. You can go forward one more slide. 7,000 Jewish businesses were destroyed. Hitler's government paradoxically blamed German Jews for the disturbances, and 25,000 Jews were incarcerated in concentration camps on account of Kristallnacht. Go forward one more. Now, these early attacks on Jews were part of what we can call the disemancipation phase of Nazi policy. In disemancipation, this means taking away the rights of citizenship from Jews. But what made Nazi racism so unique was not the disemancipation phase. It was their subsequent attempt to annihilate Jews, not only in Germany, but across Europe, through methodical genocide. So Hitler wanted Lebensraum in the East. And according to Heinrich Himmler, this would require the annihilation of 10 million Slavs, whom the Nazis regarded as subhuman. Now, to this end, Himmler authorized special SS action teams to slaughter at will in the Soviet Union once the Second World War began. So, typically we date the beginning of the Second World War in Europe on September 1, 1939. This is when the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany gobble up Poland. Actually, then there's a period of peace between the Soviet Union and Germany, which lasts until June of 1941, right on the first day of summer, the longest day of the year, when Nazi Germany undertook the largest land invasion in modern human history. Now, following behind those frontline units were these soldiers called the Einsatzgruppen. Go forward one more slide, please. And typically, these units forced their victims, many of whom were Jews, but some of whom were communists, Slavs, to dig mass graves and then line up on the rim of the grave to be shot. Millions of Soviet citizens died in this manner. Millions of Soviet citizens died in this manner. So 3.7 million Soviet prisoners of war were executed while they were prisoners of war. Now, even lower than the Slavs and the Nazi racial doctrine, were the Jews, and Hitler was determined to eradicate as many of the 11 million Jews who lived in Europe as possible. So soon after the outbreak of the war in 1939, Jews in Poland were herded into ghettos, first in the city of Lodz, and then in Warsaw and in other cities. Go forward one more slide, please. And it was from the ghettos that many Jews were sent to be killed in concentration camps. Now, these ghettos were not meant to be forms of genocide or tools of genocide themselves. But the living conditions in these ghettos were so bad that the death rate by 1942 was about 20% per year, just from starvation, exposure, disease, and so on. Now, at first, the ghettos were a temporary expedient to isolate Jews from the rest of the human community while their ultimate fate was determined. But in July of 1941, Hermann Göring, at Hitler's command, issued the fateful order for the mass murder of Jews. In the order, it was phrased as, quote, a total solution to the Jewish question in the German sphere of influence in Europe. And you'll notice here that the Germans are using euphemisms to speak of mass murder. And Hannah Arendt, who my freshman and sophomore students read in my World City class, makes quite a big point about this, that if you speak about something terrible in euphemisms, that suggests that you understand that it is terrible. Right? And so the fact that the Germans are using euphemisms to speak murder suggests that in the end they understand that this is murder. Now, the following January 1942, Nazi leaders met in a Berlin suburb, Wannsee, a very affluent suburb, to map out plans to deport Jews to camps specially equipped to exterminate large numbers of Jews in an efficient manner. And in the end, execution by machine guns was deemed too slow and costly. The preferred method was the gas chamber, after which dental fillings could be removed. And corpses were burned in crematoria. The bones and ashes could be used for fertilizer. Some corpses were boiled to produce soap. Now, the most notorious of these camps was at Auschwitz in Poland. Before one more slide, please. Auschwitz was a model of German efficiency. This is an ethnic stereotype I am employing. Germans are efficient. That's supposed to be a joke. Poor joke, not a joke in the context of Auschwitz. So Auschwitz was capable of killing 12,000 persons a day. By the end of the war, Auschwitz alone was responsible for the murder of 2.5 million persons in gas chambers and some 500,000 more by barbaric treatment. Now, the Nazis' plans to exterminate inferior peoples also included gypsies, included Jehovah's Witnesses, homosexuals, the mentally ill. Between 1938 and 1941, the Nazis perfected their gassing technique on 70,000 mentally ill German citizens. German scientists perfected a form of cyanide known as Zyklon B. But even at its most efficient, gassing took between 15 and 20 minutes to kill most of its victims. Now, at first, Allied and Jewish leaders were incredulous at reports of genocide. But even when these reports were confirmed, no effort was made to bomb either the camps or the rail lines that led to the camps. Although underground church groups, mainly Protestant ones, assisted the Jews, Pope Pius XI and his successor, Pope Pius XII, never directly condemned the atrocities, even when Jews in Rome were herded into cattle cars. Indeed, there was scant sympathy for Jews in Poland, especially among a Roman Catholic clergy that is bitterly anti-Semitic. There were instances of heroism. The Danes, the Hungarians, the Bulgarians, the Italians, they all organized large underground resistance movements that saved tens of thousands of Jews from murder. But efforts to blame this slaughter on a mere handful of deranged Nazi leaders are really indefensible. At least, estimates range here somewhere between 50 and 150,000 people were directly involved in Hitler's final solution. German soldiers, politicians, French collaborationists, Polish clergy members, the list goes on and on. Very few of these persons were ever held accountable for their crimes. So, you know, isn't there a show on TV called How to Get Away with Murder? Yeah, I think that one of the morals of the Holocaust is you get away with murder by just doing it on a very large scale. So I promise you that I would end with some thoughts about how historians have tried to make sense of the Holocaust. And you know, this is really the realm where professional historians, you as I, though what we teach in our classes is very much what I just said, right? It's the fact, right? Cultural literacy. Make sure we all know what Auschwitz was, and we all know what the human toll was. But where we reside professionally is in the realm of interpretation, and this is what historians argue about among themselves. And for several decades, debate about the Holocaust centered upon two schools of thought. These schools of thought have very unsexy names. One school is called the intentionalist school, and one school is called the functionalist school. So according to the intentionalists, the Holocaust was the product of Nazi willfulness. So the roots of the Holocaust can be found in the origins of the Nazi Party, in Hitler's Mein Kampf, in the Nuremberg Laws, and so on. So in other words, the Nazis had a master plan to destroy the Jews from day one, and once they were in power, they acted on that plan. And then opposed to the intentionalists, the functionalists. And the functionalists argue that there was no master plan, even though they had recognized the deep anti-Semitism of Nazi leaders. Instead, the functionalists argued that the Holocaust was the product of a specific confluence of events. They tend to emphasize developments that have roots deep in the German past. And this is what we call in German history the Sonderweg thesis. The Sonderweg in German means the special path. Right, in German development, German modernization, in the view of this school of thought, in the view of the functionalists, was somehow warped. It was failed modernization or partial modernization. But compared to the experience of France and Britain and the United States, it was warped. And one upshot of this Sonderweg, this special path, was the Holocaust. Now, more recently, historians have begun to look beyond this divide between the intentionalists and the structuralists. So, I've already mentioned Daniel Jordan Goldhagen. His work is very similar to the work of a historian who's now retired, I think. He was a speaker in the series a couple years ago, although I think he didn't show, right? Christopher Browning. In fact, Browning and Goldhagen use the same document base in their books. And they've tried to ascertain the individual motivations of people who participated in the killing. And right, this is an especially productive approach, I think, because we talk a lot about why people did this. Well, maybe we should actually investigate the sources that people who were involved in murder generated themselves. And that moves us beyond that scale of intentionalist structuralism. And then, going even further, Jan Gross, Polish historian at NYU, has questioned the centrality of German soldiers in the Holocaust, at least as it played out in Poland. And Gross paradoxically argues that the Holocaust could not have happened if German soldiers were not there. Right, they were the catalyst of Holocaust, but they were not necessarily the agents of Holocaust. That is, the actual killing was done not principally by German soldiers, but by Polish inventors. And this is very difficult. Jan Gross is, among other things, a great Polish patriot. And this view of the Holocaust has not been received warmly in Poland. And then another scholar whom I mentioned earlier, he's not a historian, but a sociologist, Zygmunt Bauman, places the Holocaust within the broader trajectories of modernization. And I think in some way this is similar to the Zondervan thesis, right? That the Zondervan thesis, which sees failed modernization as one of the root causes of the Holocaust, failed German modernization. But Bauman argues that the Holocaust is kind of a perverse outcome of certain ideas that are very modern. So Bauman tells us that one of the characteristics of the modern state is that the modern state tends to act like a gardener, right? It fertilizes certain parts of the population. If you're here at SSU and you're receiving a Pell Grant, you're being fertilized in Bauman's view. But modern states also weed their populations. And generally, we weed in ways that are more or less gentle. Right? Like somebody shows up at our border without a visa, we send them home. But Bauman argues that the Holocaust is a perverse form of weeding. But nonetheless, the logic behind exists in the states that are not genocide. Okay? And so in other words, Bauman is kind of breaking down the distinction between a genocidal state and a non-genocidal state. Okay. So my voice is starting to fail me, so I will stop there. And I'm happy to take questions or defer questions to others.
Explain the Zondervan thesis again.
The Zondervan, okay. So I'll spell it for you first. It's S-O-N-E-E-R-W-E-T. And that's pronounced in German, Zondervan. And it translates as special path. And this Zondervan thesis, really in the 1970s, this is all vogue among German historians. And so what these historians are doing is they are studying particularly the German 19th century, which is a short 19th century, right? The German state isn't created until 1871. So they're studying what is created in 1871 and the way that this German state then goes about modernizing itself. And they're trying to locate in that the roots of genocide. Okay? Now, I want to point out here that if there are any history majors in here, some of you may say, well, this is actually a flawed way of doing history because you're reading history backward, right? You're looking into the distant past to try to explain an event that happened several decades out. But of course, from the perspective of Germans who lived in the 1870s and the 1880s, they didn't experience Bismarckian Germany as failed modernization. In fact, one of the problems with this idea of failed modernization is it reifies the experience of the West. And reify, this is a great word. It means to treat as normal or to treat as prototypical the experience of France, Britain, and the United States. Right? And so German modernization, in the view of the Sonderweg people, fails principally because it differs from French, British, and American modernization. And that's probably a flawed way to go about doing history. Okay, any other questions?
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, I have two questions. One is, how aware were the average German citizens, not those perpetrating the action of the Holocaust, or even the average soldier, of the actions being done to commit mass genocide? And the second question kind of relates to that is, if it is a dictatorship, if it was a totalitarian society, what actions could, or you know, what even, you know, like, we have a problem, we can call our senators or call government officials, what actions could the German citizen do if there were problems of that nature, if they wish to express their ideas?
Okay, so let me start with the second. So that there are myriad forms of resistance. And you know, resistance ranged from what I would call going into inner immigration. And the characteristic example of this is a man who becomes a very prominent German historian after the Holocaust. His name is Joachim Fest. And Fest grew up in a very conservative Catholic family just outside of Berlin. And Fest's family kind of absolutely detested the Nazis. And their response to that was to try to create a sanctuary at home that was not corrupted. Now, obviously, that's not a perfect form of resistance. It still meant that Joachim and his brothers were drafted. In fact, I think one of Joachim's brothers perished on the Eastern Front. Joachim fought in France. He was actually captured by Americans. He's got this wonderful memoir called Not I. And he recounts this moment where he's captured by American soldiers. And one of these American soldiers was of German heritage, had grown up in Milwaukee. And he grabbed Joachim's rucksack, and he threw it on the ground and emptied it out. And inside this rucksack, Fest had a copy of Goethe's poetry. And this American German said, "Nazi scum do not read Goethe." And Fest was offended that this American had mistaken him as a Nazi. Because he had fought in the German army. He was a patriot, after all. But he was no Nazi. So that's probably the most mild form of resistance. But then we can, you can expand out from there. So in Munich, there was a group of university students who pamphleted the city. What was the name of this group? White Rose. White Rose, yeah. I always get solicitations from the White Rose Memorial Society. And then there's various Protestant clergymen who resisted, most famously Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who becomes the sort of hero par excellence of post-war Germany, but his moral courageousness. And then there are lots of German socialists who, after the Nazis come to power, they flee, right? They go to the Soviet Union. Then they actually fight against the Wehrmacht in the Second World War. And so there were forms of resistance that were open. Now, obviously, these are pretty extreme. It's different from writing a letter to a newspaper or calling your senator. That would have gotten you, probably that would have gotten you arrested, but not much else. Now to your first question, did people know? Yes, people know. I mean, people knew what was happening.
There was that famous exhibit of letters from the front.
thing I want to point out is that, and this comes from the work of Christopher Browning, it was okay. If you were a German soldier and it turned your stomach to participate in murder, it was okay to say, I can't do it. That was okay. And so any German soldier who argued I was just following orders, he was lying. Because lots of soldiers didn't participate. Yeah.
So when it arose to, or took up the position as well as the presidency, position, he was still under the conditions, or Jim was under the conditions that were treated as sad.
Yeah.
So who was like the governing body to look over Jim while this was happening? Because clearly he was doing that realization. He was increasing more skill than he was allowed to. He was about rearming the army much more than he was allowed to. What was the ruling force behind the Treaty of Versailles stopping?
Yeah, so you know, Germany is not occupied at the end of the First World War. So, and this is an important distinction with what happens to Germany at the end of the Second World War. So at the end of the Second World War, Germany is not a fully sovereign state. And it is not a fully sovereign state until 1989. And you probably remember this, when Germany was reunified, we called that process 4+2=1, right? And it was the four victorious powers of the Second World War, France, Britain, the United States, and the Soviet Union, the two Germanies, you add them all together, you get one Germany, 4+2=1. And that reflected the fact that even in 1989, Germany was not a fully sovereign state. Okay? It was controlled by the victorious powers of the Second World War. Now, when Weimar is created, it is a fully sovereign state. You probably know that the Ruhr is actually occupied by the French army when the Weimar Republic is unable to meet its Versailles demands. And that's actually what causes Charles Dawes to get involved and to draw up this reparation plan that involved American banks. But there is no supervisory body here to which German leaders answer. Germany is beholden by treaty to pay reparations, but treaties are violated all the time, right? And we're going to find some of our treaties are going to be violated here, sooner rather than later. Yeah.
So what was when powers transferred from to Hitler?
Okay, so when power is transferred to, so as your question, why did they do this?
I guess how is, I don't quite understand how it was
not. Okay, so this was all provided for by the German Constitution. So the German president, Paul von Hindenburg, this is mostly an ornamental position, except he has the power to invite politicians to try to form a ruling cabinet, okay? And so, of course, Weimar is complete chaos by 1933, and it's largely chaotic because nobody knows what to do about these Nazis. And there's this proposal, just ban them, just outlaw them, we'll arrest them all. And Hindenburg says, no. Can't do this in a liberal democracy. And instead, we're going to give Hitler the chancellorship. Right. This is like, do you want to go to prison or do you want chocolate cake? Everybody wants chocolate cake. But Hindenburg was convinced that by doing this, Hitler would begin to behave responsibly. Right? Because obviously he has to rule. He'll be in charge of a cabinet. There'll be three Nazis among the 11 cabinet positions. And these positions will control German government. Now, of course, that's not what happened. As soon as Hitler was appointed chancellor, he moved to consolidate his power by calling for new elections to the Reichstag, which was his prerogative. This is all constitutional. perhaps suggests that constitutions aren't necessarily very good protections against tyranny. Any other questions?
Any more?
I'm sorry, earlier when you said the part of the opposition in the military, collection basically accused multiple officers general of homosexuality of having assassinated. Was that, what happened after that? I mean, there must have been still German resistance.
Well, you know, I mean, obviously, just because you assassinate the, you know, several leading generals does not mean the opposition and the office support disappears. And you know, probably some of you know that there's an attempt to assassinate Bittner actually during the Second World War that's orchestrated by, you know, by cohort of officers and army officers. And these were all people who were convinced that, that Hitler's adventurous war in the East in particular was going to lead to the complete destruction of Germany. And so the only way to protect against that was to remove Hitler from power and then immediately sue for peace. And there's, you know, there's some talk, in my Soviet history classes we touch upon this when we talk about the origins of the Cold War. But in the spring of 1945, there was actually a meeting in Bern, Switzerland, between German officers and representatives of the United States and Great Britain. And these German officers wanted to know if Germany could surrender separately to the Western Allies. And of course, at that moment, the and apparently Churchill was more taken with this idea than Roosevelt. At that moment, the Americans insisted it had to be an unconditional surrender. But this kind of course, Stalin had spies everywhere, and this kind of reinforced this idea that, in Stalin's mind, that the Western Allies could not be trusted. That they were duplicitous, here they are negotiating with these Nazis, but nothing else. That was called Operation Sunrise, by the way. Yeah.
What was the movie on Valkyrie that the same thing?
Yeah, that's about the that's the one with Tom Cruise, right? Yeah, that's about the attempt to assassinate the...
Is that Operation Sunrise too? Yeah.
No, that's different. Operation Sunrise is the attempt to negotiate a separate peace. Yeah.
Did he appoint political people to be replacing generals, or was it just... I know they have a very strong tradition in the military, or like hierarchy.
Yeah.
Did he like let that happen? Like a point political?
Yeah, that I have complete ignorance. I just don't know.
The military people who were murdered,
yeah,
were not very familiar. They were the SA.
Yeah.
It was private property.
Yeah.
So the regular army just fell into line.
I have to ask you since you finality of evil, can you shortly summarize how that book fits into the Holocaust historical context in a way that helps us appreciate it more?
Well, this book is rather fresh in my mind. I decided to my students that I see August this year. So any other student that's read this with me? So this is just a wonderful book by Hannah Arendt. It was written originally for the New Yorker, which means that it's eminently readable, right? And in 1961, the New Yorker sent Hannah Arendt, who was teaching at the time at the New School in New York, off to Jerusalem to cover the trial. And I'll say a little bit about Hannah Arendt here. She obviously was a German Jew herself. She had fled to France when France is invaded in. At the beginning of the war, she is actually arrested in some concentration camp. She escapes from concentration camp, and she makes her way across the Pyrenees. But that's actually not the most interesting part about Hannah Arendt. The most interesting part about Hannah Arendt is when she was a university student, she had an affair with her professor. It's very frowned upon. says, how could you do this? And he says something to the effect that I was just a child, right? As if it was a trifle. But anyway, Hannah Arendt, she goes to Jerusalem and she covers the trial of this man, Adolf Eichmann. And I'll tell you a little bit about Eichmann. I mean, Eichmann was no great Nazi mastermind. Eichmann was a bureaucrat. He was a bureaucrat in the railroad ministry that orchestrated shipments of Jews to concentration camps. The subtitle of the book is a report on the banality of evil. And of course, this word banality means utterly ordinary. And Hannah Arendt's big argument in this book is that the way we envision evil in the Holocaust, or this sort of charismatic, exceptional, extraordinary evil embodied by people like Adolf Hitler, that this is probably a mistake. In that, in most instances, evil is utterly banal. It's embodied in people like Adolf Eichmann, who just wanted to impress. And so Eichmann was a joiner. He was a follower. He was not even very anti-Semitic. In fact, he wasn't an anti-Semite. That's the great paradox about him. Before the war, he was... had several discussions with Jewish rabbis about where the Zionist homeland might be. They actually talked about it being in Madagascar. In fact, he considered himself to be a Zionist. Right? So he was motivated by no great hatred. But he participated in that. So I guess the question is whether the Arendtian argument holds more broadly than just Adolf. Arendt, you know, tries to make the argument that it does, that this is how we should think about the Holocaust. But, you know, that's not good. Yeah.
Would you consider this, if you were to just throw out a generalization of the Nazis, would you consider this to be mob mentality on a large scale?
I'm not sure I know what mob mentality is.
It's sort of like a group mentality. I mean, so. I guess the easiest way to explain is that someone within the group would not consider the group's actions to be the craziest at source. But somebody looking from the outside, looking in, would they see this group that acts and does certain things together to be coordinated within, I would say, the Nazi party? So the Nazis themselves would consider that to be like a mob, and they would consider what they were doing to be like a mob mentality.
No, I'm not sure that. I mean, we shouldn't, just because these people are doing things that we find reprehensible and evil, doesn't mean that they didn't think about it, right? That they didn't ponder this, that this wasn't well thought out. In fact, we know that the genocide was, I mean, this was methodical, right? I mean, they started out using machine guns, and the machine guns were too inefficient, so then they had to figure out something else. And then even, you know, as the Red Army, you know, Stalingrad, Battle of Stalingrad is 1942, end of 42, beginning of 43. And at that moment, the Nazis are in retreat. The Germans are in retreat across the Eastern Front. And we know there are moments where the retreat was slow, so they could kill more Jews. So the military considerations are thrown to the side in order to kill more Jews. Right, and so this was the, you know, when it becomes clear that they're going to lose the war, they're going to kill as many Jews as possible. Yeah.
So, like, you know, when after World War I, Germany was, like, really, like, in trouble and stuff, and then Hitler came to power, and he basically made everything really nice, he, like, ran throughout the streets, and, like, they were really happy. And, like, as it kept on going, like, do you think at a certain point, like, the German people realized that, like, what he was doing was bad, and they're like, oh, wait, like, this isn't the best thing for our country, and we should not, like, hurt people?
Yeah, well, you know, certainly there were always German individuals that thought that. You know, I started off by saying, you know, that the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany are joined by this concept of totalitarianism. The truth is, The totalitarianism may be a useful way of thinking about state ambition. It's not actually a very useful way for thinking about the way people experience state power, right? And so there's always kind of room, even in the Soviet Union, there was room around the kitchen table, right, for subversion, for the critical comments, in pillow talk in bed at night. And so, and this was even more so. I mean, I think that the Nazi Germany was less ambitious in its, in its polarization than the Soviet Union was. And so there were always people who were opposed to this. There were always people who thought this is a disaster and we are going to pay for a very long time for what this madman is doing. Like Joachim Fest, right? Who was no Nazi, but felt it was his patriotic duty to fight in the German military. So there were always people who thought. There's a wonderful novel about this by a German writer named Hans Falada. I think the English title is No Man Dies Alone, or something like that, about a family whose son dies on the Eastern Front, and then they begin to, these sort of small forms of subversion, sending an anonymous postcard to somebody, with an anti-Hitler message, or scrolling something on a bathroom stall. So that these forms of resistance were really pretty ubiquitous, but nothing ever came of them.